Hi, everybody, and I hope you're all safe where you are. As many of you may know, Nick and I started a fundraiser called Together for India with our partners in Give India. And there have been incredible donations, people from all over the world that have helped us raise tremendous amount of money. But Give India is India's most trusted online donation platform. And the other day I was just getting an update from them about what is happening on the ground and what the situation is like. And I just thought that you guys would be interested in knowing where your donations have gone and what actually is happening and the work that's happening on ground. So I wanted to invite Atul Satija, who's the founder and the CEO of Give India, to answer a few of the questions that you guys have also sent to me. And a lot of people may or may not be wondering. So first of all, hi Atul, how are you? I hope you and your family are safe where you are.
Hi Priyanka, thank you so much for this opportunity for us to come and talk about the COVID work we are doing. Touch wood, we've been okay so far.
That's great. It's so amazing the kind of work that you guys are doing on ground. I mean, COVID-19 has hit India, as most of the world knows, in such a massive way. And it's so heartening to see citizens rallying together, people around the world rallying together to come out and help, because until everyone is safe, no one is really safe. So it's really, really wonderful and heartening to see people doing the best that they can. Every small drop counts. So I would just love to hear from you, how this started, how you got into it, and what's happening on ground at the moment.
Yeah, so Priyanka, let me first start by saying thank you for choosing to do what you are doing right now. I think you've inspired a lot of people to come forward, individuals, influencers, to also follow your lead and actually do what is required right now to help people in the country. I think, as you mentioned, the fundraiser that you're doing has been very successful. I think we have raised close to about 7.5 crores thanks to your and Nick's lead here. We have been able to procure about 500 oxygen concentrators, about 422 oxygen cylinders, and the money is also helping us support 10 vaccination centers for about 2 months. And that will help another 6,000 people to get vaccinated. So we identified early on that, among all the things that we need in the healthcare infrastructure, what we need most is the oxygen supply. So a lot of the funds from your campaign have been deployed to make the maximum impact in that area.
So just to understand for people and for me, what is the process with which, Give India identifies the need that is on the ground, and then how does your distribution structure work?
So Priyanka, over the last 21 years, we built a very large network of trusted partners on the ground. We have 2,000 nonprofits that we work with on the ground, day in, day out. So whenever something like this happens that triggers a need for a response, we start getting inputs from our nonprofit partners on what do they need on the ground. We also talk to charitable hospitals, government authorities based on. So when we started receiving requests from them, we realized that a lot of the need is on the medical side to start with. One very specific example is we have this charitable hospital in Mount Abu in Rajasthan. Distances are very long there, right? So they wanted about 27 to 30 oxygen concentrators there. So with your money, the minute we got the first material landed in Delhi, we were able to ship 25 concentrators to them, and we have patients really using them there on the ground right now.
That's amazing to hear, and makes me feel like, sitting away from India, it's such a helpless feeling. And I think for most people who are, concerned about the country, have family. I mean, I don't think I know anyone who's not been touched by COVID, in India specifically right now. So the need is so dire, and it's really reassuring to hear that, you have your ear to the ground. But a question that I usually get is the actual disbursement of the funds, like when the funds are raised. How do you distribute them? Where do they go? How does that happen? How long does it take? Like just the process for people to feel reassured that when they're actually making donations, that their donations are reaching the right people. Just to understand who it goes to, how you decide, how long does it take from the time someone makes a donation, et cetera.
Yeah. So, Brika, in the cases of where the disbursement is a cash grant to the nonprofit, the process is very straightforward. The minute we get the money in our bank account, we basically are able to, with a 3 to 4 day lag, able to release money to the nonprofit. We have a steering committee based on the needs that we get on the ground, from the ground, our team verifies that need. Once we have a verified need, we table it to a steering committee that's an independent body to approve the proposal. Once we get their approval, we release the money. So that's about a 2 to 3 day, 4 day delay. In cases where we have to give material like oxygen concentrators, cylinders, or stuff like that, what we do is once we have the money, we already have the need and we already have the vendors identified. The minute we get the money, we are able to make a purchase order on those pre-verified vendors. And the minute we are able to get the material, we straight away move the material from the airports or if it is within the country, from the plant straight away to the nonprofit partners or hospitals, as the case may be. And that process is mostly the long pole there is, the manufacturing and the material availability. In the case of concentrators, it sometimes takes a couple of weeks because they are being imported. Or in case of plants, it takes 3 weeks or 4 weeks as well. But if it is cylinders within the country, that's like a 48 hours, 72 hours kind of delay.
I can't believe we're actually sitting here, Atul, and having conversations like this. Just for people watching, just to understand, how did we get here? Like, how did we get here? And how long do you think, just because your ear is to the ground, how long do you think it'll take for us to be able to, you know, this for this curve to at least be curtailed with the numbers that are right now?
It's a very difficult one to comment on, Priyanka, because so many medical experts are looking at it. Governments are trying to sort of figure out how to fight it. And I think in the short term, the saving grace is that as fast as the number climbed up, they're also coming sharply down, at least in big cities. Unfortunately, it is actually moving towards the entire country in rural areas where we know that the healthcare infrastructure is very weak. At least compared to the cities, it's very, very weak. So the wave is traveling, and I hope it very quickly leaves and gives us time to vaccinate the country well, and we are able to reduce the damage that it's causing right now. So that's our sort of hope. I hope it in the next month or so, we are able to see that the wave is sort of subsided and giving us room and space to react thoughtfully and vaccinate everyone.
Yeah, it's unbelievable and so scary. And we've talked about this before, but the ground reality is that, you know, with the way the curve is moving, Nick and I were talking about this the other day, and we wanted to sort of extend our support to, you know, other long-term needs like humanitarian aid, of course, the urgent need of oxygen support and stuff we've been doing. And, you know, the mission of getting oxygen to people is most crucial. But, you know, like you're talking about, COVID is hitting and moving towards, you know, rural areas, poorer communities, and to prevent people from starving and, you know, with not having jobs and not having food. So Nick and I really wanted to get into extending support to, you know, raise funds to provide cooked meals or even dry rations to families that don't have an opportunity right now, especially outside of the urban cities. What is GivIndia doing for that? Are you working with nonprofits that provide that kind of support?
So Priyanka, the main, a large part of our nonprofit portfolio actually provides humanitarian aid. We closely supported about 2.5 lakh people with cash relief, and a very large number of people, 50 lakh plus people, we provided food and dry rations last year. This year also, the reality is actually equally bad, if not worse. We work in communities in Jharkhand with tribal families, and we saw that their income levels came down, Priyanka, from 750 rupees or so a week to about 150 rupees a week now. So imagine when you're living at the margin and 75% of your income disappears. There was a study from Azim Premji University recently that said COVID-19 is pushing about 230 million people back in poverty, more in urban than in rural, but still the percentages are very, very high. So it has had a very, very large impact on hunger, malnutrition. I mean, all the kids who were actually in schools getting midday meals, 95 million of them, they're not getting midday meals right now, which is the only source of meaningful nutrition for them. So lockdowns is also causing, you know, more and more damage here. So what we are doing is we are already working with about 60 nonprofits, and we have disbursed a few million dollars to them, specifically for food and dry rations. Sometimes these ration kits are for a week, sometimes a fortnight, sometimes a month. And they are helping not just daily wages or migrant workers, but they're also helping municipal staff, orphanages, elderly in need, sick patients, hospices, and all the other people as well. So I think your support in this area is very timely as well. I think it'll make a real impact on the ground.
I mean, look, we are here to do whatever we can. Please lean on Nick and I as your partners. And I just want to say thank you so much for taking the time, for clarifying, answering so many of our questions. And just to everybody out there, I would just say that, you know, every donation counts. You can see where your money is going. You can see that your money is going to the right place. Right now, India really, really needs our help, whether it comes to procurement of medical equipment, oxygen cylinders, concentrators, vaccination support, food, ration. This is the time to step up. And like Atul just told us about, you know, the stat that has come out that the pandemic has actually pushed 230 million Indians into poverty. And that has a direct impact on, you know, malnutrition and hunger, and that has a direct impact on society and the future of the country. So please feel responsible. I urge you to donate. We can help. And please know that your money is in the right hands and your money is going to people who actually need aid. So thank you to all of you who came out and donated. Thank you to all of you who have helped. And especially, Atul, to you and your team at Give India and all the NGOs that are doing such selfless God's work. I'm so grateful that we have people like you who have set up and thought about, you know, helping the country get back onto its feet. So thank you so much for your goodness. And thank you to everyone who donated. And please continue to donate.
Priyanka, thank you. And huge shout out to you as well from all of us at Give India. We're very grateful for all the support we've been getting. And I think what you've started has already become a people's movement. And what really India needs is your support now. Thank you.
Of course, always. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.